Hey, my name is Ben, and I teach you how to write Unity shaders from scratch. In today's video, we're going to go through this effect where you can see the objects behind it in this, you know, one colored or two colored format, right? This object can be scaled, it can be moved, it can also, you can also change the colors if you want, you know, on the fly, right? So yeah, cool. Let's jump right into it. So in this particular lesson, there will be some techniques that are a little bit more advanced than what I've shown you so far. But do bear with me, try to go through them, and I will try to cover them more in depth in a future video. But I'll also briefly explain what each one does. So the Unity setup we have today is very simple. It's a game camera and a scene camera. The reason why I've separated these two and showing you both is so that you can see the difference between the two. Because especially when it comes to using depth textures, it looks a little different in both. The shader setup is very simple. Black is what we're outputting, and this shader is attached to this black sphere. Behind, we have all these objects that we can use that will show up in the depth texture. So this shader will take advantage of the depth texture. The depth texture is actually given to us by Unity. When we sample it, it's actually free to sample because it's already created by Unity. So we just need to grab it from Unity and sample it. It's as simple as that. Now, in order to sample this depth texture, we need something called screen space UVs, because the depth texture encompasses the entire screen. Okay, so let me show you how to get screen space UVs. Float 4 in the V2F, we'll call it screen space. We'll put it in textCoord1. The math can be done here in the vertex, and then we'll pass it over to the UV. Into the fragment. So we'll do o.screenSpace. Unity has a function for us already. It's called compute screen pos. And what we need to do is pass in the vertex. We have to pass in the one that's already in clip position. Now, in order for us to view the screen space UVs, it's we'll do float 3. Float 2, my bad, not float 3. Screen space UV, and what we need is i.screenSpace.xy, which is the computed space for us, divided by the W. So you can do your own research on why it's using divide by W. I believe it's to fix up the projection, especially when it comes to this camera. It's a projected camera, yeah, perspective camera. So it does, I believe, some math to kind of fix it up. So let's display the UV here. Cool. So as you can see, it's worked out. When we bring the circle to the bottom right here, you can see that it's getting to red. To the top, it's becoming yellow in this corner, green in the other corner, green in this corner, and probably black at this bottom corner, right? Can't quite see it. There we go. Black here. So we can see that this sphere, or the UVs, is encompassing the entire screen. It's not based on the sphere itself, but it's based on the screen itself. So the screen space texture is already, sorry, the depth texture is already given to us. It's given to us by unitycg.cginc. So all we need to do is declare it here, and we should be able to access it. The declaration is sampler2d camera depth texture. Now, sampling this thing is a little bit different than sampling a texture. We cannot just use a text2d sample. I believe Unity has its own way of sampling it. It has another, it's kind of like transform text, it has its own way to sample it, because depending on the version of device you're using, it could be a projection sample, it could sample only in the red channel. There's a bunch of different ways to do it, so I always use the one that Unity gives us. So the one Unity gives us is called sample depth texture. I think it's as simple as that, actually. So we'll do float depth is equal to sample underscore depth underscore texture, right? And what we need is the depth texture given to us by Unity, and we need the screen space. Let's output that to see what it looks like. We'll output it just in the red. Okay, so I think this has worked. There's no errors, so I believe this has worked. but we need to decode this. This is given, this is coming to us in a way where we cannot even see the red. There might be a reddish tinge here, as you can kind of see a little bit right here, but it's quite invisible. So we need to decode it. There's two ways to decode it. I think I remember it. It's called linear I depth. Let's save that off. Yeah. So this is the first way to decode it. And right now we're seeing just red. And you, I think Unity actually uses this one to determine if objects should draw behind or in front of each other. But from our perspective, from our eye, we cannot see it. I think there are differences in this red up close and further away, right? You can kind of see it, but it's not linear. So I guess it's kind of a naming issue, but if you want it to be linear between 0 and 1, that is 0 and 1 based on this camera, instead of I, I believe we put 0, 1. And there we go. That is probably what you guys were more expecting. Now you can see all of the objects behind it with this depth going on. And you can also see that it doesn't actually work in the scene camera. It doesn't, it does, but it doesn't look the same as what is in the game camera. So you got to make sure the game camera is there for this to work. Now keep in mind, linear, because this is a depth texture, it is based off of the camera. It is based off of the near and far plane. So if I change this to 1, or I change the far to say 100, it will actually change this, the look of this, right? So I brought it to 15, wherever it is close to just enough to see this blue box. So you can see the full effect here, right? So make sure that when you are doing this effect, your near and far plane are set properly. So now that is done, there's a couple things we can do to make this more advanced. We can do two colors and lerp between the two. So let's go ahead and do that. All right, so I've created color one, color two. No errors, that's good. So let's do a mixed version. Let's just do a new color, float. And we'll do floats for now and maybe convert it to fixed later. We'll do mixed color. We'll lerp between the first one, color one and color two. We'll lerp it based on the depth. Cool, so now when we select this object, we can select different types of colors. Let's just say we want, we want the objects near us to be dark, and we want the further ones to be kind of this reddish tinge, or even purple or blue. So we can kind of, you know, we can do what we want here. So I think I'll leave it into this type of color. So as I was doing this object, I thought, you know what, it would be really cool if we can make a, draw an edge around it, right? And we're in 3D space. We have this sphere in 3D. So why don't I add a quick Fresnel to this? For those of you that don't know, Fresnel is a dot product between the normal and the view direction. So that means as we see the grazing angles, like of the edge of the sphere, it becomes white or it becomes hotter. And as the sphere is directly reflecting back at us, or the normals of the sphere is looking back at us, we see this texture. So why don't we quickly add that? I think I'll do a separate video on exactly how Fresnel works if this is a little bit confusing, but we'll just quickly put it in for now. For that to work, we need the normal from the app data. And from here, we need to pass in two things. We need the view direction and we need the normal. This will be textcode 2. Textcode 3 for the view direction. To get the normal from the vertex, it's o.normal is equal to, it's always in local space, so we need to make sure it is in world space. And I think it's Unity object to world and normal. I think that's it. If not, I'll Google it after. and we need the v.normal. Save that off, see if it works. Yes. Okay, and the view direction is quite simple too. ViewDir. It's world space view direction. So we just need the vertex position. I believe of the V of the object. So. And because we are converting it to world space view direction, I think these are not normalized, so we need to normalize it. Okay, let's quickly display our Fresnel. We'll do a separate value. We'll call it float Fresnel. I know it looks like Fresnel, but it's not. we'll just do a quick dot product of i.viewDirection and i.normal. Let's just see if that quickly works. Yes, it does. Cool. To get the edges, we need to do a 1 minus on it. All right, and if we took our Fresnel and we multiplied it with our mixed color, should get the effect we're looking for. Not quite. We don't need the 1 minus. There we go. Okay. So now what if you wanted this edge to have like a bit of a color, right? So why don't we quickly do that? We'll do maybe, you know what? We'll put the main text there. How about we do that instead? So if we look at our Fresnel again, it's going from white or red to the edge dark. So what we want is, we do want the 1 minus actually. Okay, so now the edges are white, right, or red. And if we want to use our cull, what we can do is we can do a final color. Float 3 final color is equal to lerp between our mixed color, which is going to be the black, to our cull, which is the red, times, no, lerp it by Fresnel, for now. Cool. So now that is working and it's using this texture. So whenever you do Fresnels, right, some people like to do ramps to kind of make the edge brighter, right? So ramps, especially on the Fresnel itself, will cause it to brighten at the edge. It's like kind of a, like a multiplier, but exponentially. So let's do a ramp on the Fresnel. So I'll call it ramp. Going to be a float defaulted to 1 because it's a power, and our Fresnel can now have a pow power by the ramp, and that should be it actually, right? We got to make sure we use put ramp here so we can use it. Cool. Now our ramp is 1. If we set it to say 10, no, that might be too much. 2, yeah, we can start to push it against this edge, right? And we can also have a multiplier. We'll multiply it onto this for now. We can also, animate this if we wanted to. I'll just quickly add it here. So yeah, in order for us to see this, I think we would have to play it because it doesn't properly animate here. Yeah, and there you go. That's the effect we were aiming for. So now you have this effect that can scale up. Looks like this. I don't know if this water texture is really the right type of texture for this, but Yeah, you can do all sorts of cool things with this. You can change out this green, you can change out, you can have a lot of fun with this one. So I went ahead and also did this a little bit more advanced version. It's called the advanced depth as opposed to the test depth that I was showing you guys earlier. But this advanced one, all it did is change the way I'm sampling the UVs to this rotational type effect. I just thought it would be pretty cool, especially with this sphere that we have. I don't think it'll work very well on all types of objects though, but it probably won't work well on cubes and stuff like that. But it works well on, you know, spheres, mostly spheres, rounded objects, things like that, because it relies on the Fresnel to work, right? So I'll post this in the description if you guys want. And if you really want an in-depth version of how this one works, I'm more than happy to do that, but it's just an adaptation of what we have here. I just changed the ways I was sampling the texture. So yeah. So if you guys like what you see, please like, subscribe, and support my channel. Hope you guys learned something, and I'll see you next time. Bye now.